And I was asked this morning to talk about the office space market. Let me just check that this is working. I got it. Okay. Right. Thanks. So I guess it's my job to come and tell you that the market is heading for a little bit of oversupply. This isn't anything particularly remarkable because the market, as probably most of you know, the office space market does tend to follow these long periods of relative oversupply when rents are quite stable, nothing very much happening, very little growth. Then we have short periods, short bursts where there's a relative undersupply, and then the next generation of buildings kick in and we start all over again. So the last little period of undersupply was way back in 2008. It seems an awful long time ago then. There was one renewal I remember done in Manara Citibank at about 6 ringgit something, and everybody thought, wow, this is really big time. Office space is now on the path to recovery. Then, of course, the global financial crisis kicked in, and everything settled back again. And, of course, KL remains one of the inflation busters, if you like, one of the most reasonable and low-priced places to actually situate your office. We celebrate 100 this year, which means that we actually turn 100 million square feet of office space in Greater KL. And that's really something. We have the second highest amount of office space per capita in the region. And just to put our size in perspective, we're bigger than Singapore. We are just under Hong Kong, which has about 120 million square feet. Not that much less than us, we're getting there. And we're about on par with Bangkok and Manila. So where has all the growth been? Well, where's the screen for a start? Okay, over here. So basically, I don't want to bore you this morning with a lot of statistics, and these will be available later if you want them. Yeah. But the bottom layer here is KL City Center, and you'll see since 05 to 14, some growth, but not spectacular growth in size, and then just outside the City Center, a lot of growth. We've gone from, I think we've just about doubled in size. And then what's really happened, the real growth statistically, has been in the rest of Selangor, which is waking up and beginning to build its own office buildings. So are we going to continue like this is the big question. Will the new MRT and LRT systems serve to bring people back into the city? And so are we going to see more development in the city? Or will it just, will the trend continue that we're going to see more development outside of the city? And I think looking ahead, we probably are going to see two things. One is the polarization of office space as planned, so that oil and gas will gather around Twin Towers. And then we're going to see the polarization of the big financial institutions around the new TRX, which is a well-planned, ambitious, but very successful extension of the Golden Triangle. And despite all the bad press that 1MDB has been getting recently, TRX is actually a very well-founded, logical development, which has attracted a number of genuine owner-occupants. customers. So it's pretty well, as far as the commercial sites that they have available, it's pretty much full house. All they've got to do is build it. So you're going to see these two very attractive centers of gravity within the Golden Triangle. And then I think there will continue to be a lot of office space built in suburban areas. And that's good for two reasons. One is that if you're living in, you know, Sungai Buloh, for example, or even in PJ, it doesn't make a lot of sense to have to get into the city every day to work. And so your quality of life will increase leaps and bounds. Secondly, we're seeing, as a new trend in the office market, we're seeing a lot of interest now from back office operators and from call centers. At one time, Singapore dominated this market. A lot of it migrated to Manila, where you have a very large, very underpaid English-speaking population. And now a fair amount of it appears to be considering KL as a location. And they don't need to be in the city center. They like big floor plates, relatively inexpensive space, and in that space they will cram little cubicles which operate 24/7 to a density of about one person per 70 square feet or thereabouts. I mentioned that density just to digress a little bit because there are building codes which require a density of no less than one person per 100 square feet. And I think it's about time these were reviewed, because if you build your little cubicles to one person per 100 square feet, you simply can't cram enough in to make the whole operation competitive. So if Malaysia wants to attract this type of activity, which I'm not convinced it does because it's a bit down market, but if they do, then these building codes, sooner or later, in KL and PJ, are going to have to be reviewed. But I just mentioned that in passing. Just put you in the picture as far as supply is concerned. We are looking at an additional in 2015, about 7 million square feet. Next year, probably another 7 million square feet. And the year after, so far, it looks like about 5 million square feet. Can the market absorb all of this? No. This is not a. These are not supply figures of sort of life-threatening proportions, and we have to accept that there is this trend now to better grade office buildings. So you'll see that less than 15% of the space in the city centre is really what we would call grade A. Slightly higher percentage in the suburbs, but that's because suburban office developments are all relatively more recent. And suburban office development never really took hold until about 1990. So obviously, the suburban stock is newer than the traditional KL city center. So you look at KL Central, for example, none of those buildings are more than, 10, 12 years old. Whereas in the city, you can still see some buildings that go back to the 70s. What is grade A? Well, I'll talk about that a little more later, but I just mentioned again in passing that KL doesn't have an official set of standards and criteria for grade A. So that's one of the reasons why MSC status has become the magnet for many tenants, is because it's become a proxy for grade A. So you know if a building has MSC status, then it has certain physical attributes, mechanical and electrical equipment, dual power supply, high redundancy and emergency power, and so on and so forth, which makes it virtually a grade A building. So no official grade A designation is great, because as agents you can call practically every building grade A. What do we think is grade A? I've just thrown in a list here of recent buildings that are built to a very, very high standard. And I think that's something else that we should celebrate in KL, is the diversity and the quality and the spectacular appearance of many of the new office buildings that we're getting. Things are changing very fast. People who go away and come back again to KL after 5 or 10 years inevitably tell you, wow, this isn't the city that we used to know. But it's shaping up into a very, very attractive city, still retains a lot of greenery, public transport is improving, and there is a lot in the urban fabric that we can be very, very proud of. Just coming back to my earlier point about age, this is the, this thing's got a mind of its own. This is the supply by age, and you'll see if you look at the right-hand column that KL suburban space is relatively newer. This is really an agent opportunity, you know, because there is this flight to quality. Many of the older buildings don't provide the facilities and the mechanical and electrical equipment that suits a modern office. You can't survive without IT these days. And so companies tend to move when their IT installations and their server rooms are clapped out. And once they've moved, they will stay until the next time around. Companies are fairly sticky, and you'll expect them to stay for 6 or 9 years before they move on. But moving from older buildings to newer buildings is a phenomenon that has continued for the last 3 or 4 years and will continue. Don't forget, a lot of these older buildings, some of which you're seeing are already being redeveloped even after 30 years. Some of them were built to a very low plot ratio of 4 to 1 or less. And the site value is rapidly overtaking the value of the completed building. When the site value is more than the building value, land and building value, then you know that it's time to redevelop. And that is exactly what is happening downtown. A little photo tour of new buildings that were completed last year. As I said, some very handsome buildings. High quality, and some of them quite huge. What have we got to look forward to this year? IB Tower, Menara Bangkok Bank, the NASA buildings in Platinum Park, which is a very beautiful development just across from KLCC, the massive Damansara City, Pusat Bandar Damansara, which is where my office happens to be, and Q Central in KL Central. Over 1 million square feet net of office space. And you know, I'm going to talk a little bit about agency in office buildings, because I understand many of us here this morning are agents, is that right? And it's always been a puzzle to me that we haven't seen more people coming into office agency. When you think about it, residential agency is a bit of a zoo. It's challenging, to say the least. You're dealing with a whole variety of people, some of whom may not be terribly reliable. And yet, in office agency, you've got your buildings easily identified. You, by and large, know who the tenants are going to be, because they are the tenants in existing older buildings. And I think it's no secret that most developers of office buildings, in fact, never give sole agency to agents. It may appear that they do, but if you scratch the surface a little bit, you'll find that 90% of those agents who appear to have sole agencies over large buildings, if they do, actually under an obligation to accept introduction of tenants from anybody, from any registered agent. So you would think that that would be a very fertile ground for a specialist agent to develop some expertise in office space. And yet, the mindset just isn't there yet. And I think you could make a very good business, in my view, just focusing on even one or two buildings. I mean, look at Q Central, for example. Over 1 million square feet of space. I think a lot of it sold off on strata title. A lot of owners anxious to let. And yet there's no particular agent that is identified with this major building. 1 million square feet at even 6 ringgit per square foot represents potential 6 million ringgit in commission. But there's nobody there who's known as sort of Mr. Q Central, the go-to guy if you want space in the building. And there must be an opportunity there for some enterprising agents. I'm sure you're familiar with the way that office agency works. I mean, I suppose, really only got to grips with it when we became CBRE. My personal experience, if I can bore you with my personal experience. And then it dawned on us that most multinationals tend to parcel up their real estate advice and services geographically, so that a very large multinational will give, say, Southeast Asia to XYZ company, and then maybe UK and Europe, or UK, Europe and Africa to ABC company. And XYZ or ABC, even though they may be at the end of the day acting for the landlord, are given the exclusive right to look after these particular companies. When I say look after, that is when they need something, even a tenancy renewal, or they need new space, they will go to this company. And this is business that is very hotly contested and competed for, and it, in our experience, normally goes only to the very big names in the business. But it doesn't matter, because it's not a total lockout situation. You, as an independent agent, if you like, there is nothing to prevent you from identifying those multinationals, asking them if they want to move, and offering them space. Getting an agency appointment from the landlord is not difficult at all. And in situations where that's happened, inevitably the appointed service provider has to recognize the other agent's introduction. So there's plenty to do in the market, normally. However, unfortunately, I've got to say, last year was a terrible year for the office market, and only about 300,000 square feet was transacted. In a good year, we look for the whole market to do between 2 and 3 million square feet. And this is a figure that hasn't changed very much over the last 5 or 6 years, but last year was particularly slow. The year before was very much better. This year, we were hopeful that things would improve, but with the price of oil going through the floor, the two or three major oil and gas companies that were in the market looking for 100, 150,000 square feet have shelved those plans, much to the disappointment of a number of landlords, many of whom thought that they had these tenants in the bag. So that has had a very negative impact on the sentiment in the office market, and we expect the asking rentals in CBD, particularly around Twin Towers area, which is where those companies normally locate, those asking rentals will decline this first half of this year. Not good news, but as I said, countered to some extent by a pickup in interest in suburban space. So as an agent, there is always something to do. If you look at the transactions last year, quite miserable. Nothing very sexy there at all. In fact, the biggest is 80, well, Cap Square, AIA, 135,000 square feet. Vacancy rates are the subject of much speculation in the press. We do expect them to increase, but again, as I said earlier, not life-threatening. They're hovering around 13, 14%, 15% right now. Could drop as low as, or as high, I should say, as 20% before they start to recover. 20% is not good. That means 80% occupancy overall. However, I've seen 70% in my lifetime, and I don't regard 80 as being particularly alarming. Asking rents, the highest asking rents that we've seen in recent history have been in Tower 3, Petronas Tower 3, which was the building that was completed a couple of years ago. And basically what happened was that Petronas moved all their non-Petronas partners, that is all their all the independent exploration and production partners, out of Tower 2 into Tower 3, so that Petronas end up occupying pretty much 100% of the twin towers, and all of the private sector went into Tower 3. And I suppose it has to be said that it didn't really matter what rent they paid, because the cost of the rent came out of the oil production under their normal producing agreements, so that if you tell them it's 12 ringgit a square foot, the tenant will say, okay. And then if you tell them the landlord's decided it's going to be 14 ringgit a square foot, they'll say, okay. So the building filled very, very quickly. Next to that, Integra Tower, which, as we know, is currently on the market. And this is going to be the benchmark for office values in KL when the deal is done. Because if you look historically at office transactions over the last two or three years, you would see an average value per square foot of less than 1,000 a square foot. But we all know that the next one is going to be well over 1,000 a square foot, and the next one is most likely going to be Integra Tower. So the market valuation profession is all watching to see where those numbers shake down. Monaro Maxis at 10 ringgit a square foot has been a phenomenal success and a tribute to its location, the quality of the management, and the aggressive approach taken by the management to keep the rents up. So it is simply one of the best buildings in KL, and if you want to be in one of the best buildings in KL, their view is that you go pay for it. You will see that rents in Selangor, that is outside of Greater KL, of course, are very much lower than rents in the city center, as you would expect, because land values, of course, are very much higher in the city center. And we don't see that this matrix is going to change very much over the next few years. There will always be this differential. Major development coming up outside of the city center is going to be PJ Central, which I think will be done by MRCB now. And that will be around and behind the old PJ Hilton. So it'd be very interesting to see the way that shapes up. I suppose the The interesting thing is that there is no stigma attached to having your office outside of the city anymore, so that it's perfectly acceptable, provided you're not a major oil and gas producer, or provided you're not a major financial institution. There's no problem being in PJ or in Damansara, or even in areas such as Mutiara Damansara. These are all now perfectly acceptable office locations. Are we cheap? Yes, we are cheap. If you look at the left-hand graph, you'll see that we're still some of the cheapest office space in the region. Singapore being the highest, followed by Hong Kong, Tokyo. How much space do we have per capita? As I said just now, Hong Kong has 16.4 square feet per person. We follow not that far behind at 13.8 square feet per person. This doesn't give you the absolute numbers. The estimate of what is grade A is relatively low. If you ask Singaporeans how much grade A space they've got, they'll tell you only about 2 million square feet. Doesn't sound right, does it? 2 million square feet is just a couple of large KL buildings. But Singapore has some very exacting standards for what they call grade A. If you were to sell an office building in KL, you would expect to sell it at a yield of about 6% net to the buyer. Amount of transactions has varied. It's usually between 1 and 2 billion a year. Again, fantastic opportunity for agents. We all dream of doing one or two of these major office sales in our lives. And again, the buildings are easily identified. The buyers are largely domestic these days, not so much foreign funds. So again, easily identified, they include the REITs and other large financial institutions. But sadly, it's very much a seller's market, and these large office buildings very, very seldom change hands. You'll see on average maybe one or two a year. These are some recent transactions, which is, if you like, more of a takeaway. I'm not going to run through the whole list, just for your general interest. What do people look for in an office building? Of course, location is important. Then it's most likely that the filter process will look at the building quality, because it's most likely that these prospective tenants are moving because the quality of their existing building just doesn't measure up anymore. So they want to see 24/7 access. They want to see plenty of emergency power generation. Excuse me. They want to see big floor plates, which I'll come to in a minute, and very flexible aircon. Every tenant's dream is to have aircon that you can turn on and off yourself on a zone system, so that if you want to occupy just one corner of the office after hours, you just flick one switch and you only air condition that one corner. Total costs, of course, are important, so that everybody, when they go out to look for space, know their budget. But it's a relative thing. You know, we find that a lot of companies that are moving from older buildings to newer buildings are paying maybe 1 or 2 ringgit per square foot per month more. That is not a big deal. What is a big deal is the cost of fit out when they move. And you know, to build a modern office building costs, let's say, 500 or 600 ringgit per square foot on the net area. And we've seen some tenants spend that much again in fitting out their offices by the time they've paid for all of their IT installation, fancy partitioning. Excuse me. They're up to around 500 or 600 ringgit a square foot, believe it or not. Amenities in the building are very important these days, so tenants look for good food and other facilities, including recreational facilities. Parking, of course, is a constant bugbear, and unless you've got at least one space per 1,000 square foot, you're not in the game. They're looking for ease of subdivision and partitioning so that some of the weird-ass floor plans that you see in even some modern office buildings just don't cut it, because it reduces the amount of usable space. I'll come to that in a minute. Views, kind of important, but not that important in my experience. Tenants are becoming increasingly conscious of the quality of property management going forward, and then green certification. I know that green certification should be higher on this list, and we're all very environmentally conscious these days, but in fact, when you come down to the nitty-gritty, we find only a very small proportion of multinationals are insisting on green certification yet. If you want to future-proof your building, you've got to have it. But at the moment, it's not such a big deal. It never ceases to amaze us how architects can take a nice regular site and then create an office building that is almost unlettable. I'm not saying that these are unlettable, but these are, just for your general information, a variety of floor layouts. That you will find in chaos. If you're building a modern office building now, your net floor area has to be at least 12,000 square feet to be able to cater for large multinationals. It will probably have a central core, top left-hand corner, yeah, that's a central core, with nice, regular, rectangular shape. You want to try and avoid two cores, which means that you have to run a corridor between them for bomber purposes, and that immediately reduces the utility of your space. So do very large columns. We find that circular shapes, although they give you quite a nice view, are often quite difficult to partition if you intend to partition them. And then, of course, you do get some very odd shapes, some of which are very difficult to subdivide or partition. You want to aim for about 80% net to gross usable space if you can. And the other problem that we very often experience, which isn't really demonstrated here very well, is that architects tend to put very large columns in the best corners, or worse still, just set in from the best corners. The best corners are where the boss normally sits to get the best view, and there's no point in putting a column just set in, which would in effect be right in the middle of the boss's office. It immediately reduces the rental value of the space and the entire building. So again, in terms of mechanical and electrical installations, tenants look for a very durable building envelope, lower maintenance costs, superior security, very, very important. Turnstiles now are the norm. High-speed lifts, of course, it goes without saying. Dual power supply, which is what you get with MSC status buildings, which basically means that if one incoming power supply fails, you have a backup. Flexible air conditioning, very, very important indeed. Raised floors so that you can run cables underneath are still often required. High ceilings, 2.7, 2.8 meters. fiber optic cabling backbone,
for obvious reasons,
provision for the disabled, MSC status and green certification. nice to have childcare, good food, and good building management. Just a few examples of good master developments. These are the sort of things that Malaysia does very, very well indeed. Large-scale commercial developments, highly successful. Bangsa South is one of them. Cyberjaya should not be overlooked as a success story, both in concept and physical design. And there's a whole big community out there in Cyberjaya which is growing, and again represents a great business opportunity. Finally, or almost finally, the outlook for this year, as I said, office rents are weakening a little. Tenants always prefer to remain where they are, but will move when they have to. Polarization of space between Twin Towers and the Tun Razak Exchange. More development in suburbs and outlying areas. And we think a pickup in demand later this year and next year. Next year we expect oil prices to recover. Those oil and gas companies will inevitably come back into the market. As agents, you should be ready for that. Excuse me. The economy is going to improve. The demographics are strong. We have more. In fact, the government is committed in its transformation program to create more white-collar workers, all of whom will be getting office jobs and offices need accommodation. So in the future, as I say, we are going to have a greater, a much larger service industry. We will be going to work by rail. We will have an almost unrecognizable city, because this new generation of buildings and the next are striking and huge, and plot ratios, if anything, are increasing, so that people are building 10, 12 to 1 is not unusual, even up to 14 or 16 to 1 in KLCC area. Plenty more A-grade offices and a city to be proud of. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Nixon. My question would be this. There's going to be that fast trade between Singapore and KL.
Yes.
And I think that will be in place in a couple of years' time. Yeah. Firstly, how will that impact the KL office market? Because I think cost of operations would be substantially cheaper in KL in comparison to Singapore.
Yeah.
However, there's also office space in Iskandar. So will that really have a big bearing on the office space market? That's one. Two, now with virtual offices, right, and more people working from home, in the longer term, is that really going to have a negative impact on the office spaces in KL?
Yeah.
I just want your thoughts.
Yeah, very good questions, yeah. The development of a high-speed train, well, studies around the world have shown that quite often the impact of a high-speed rail isn't really as much as all that, because as it is, you can easily fly or drive or take the train even to Singapore from here and vice versa. So it just facilitates travel. It's not going to be, I think, in the short and medium term, it may not have that much impact on the office space market in KL. But perhaps, if anything, there will be improved communication between the two cities, and people will wake up to the fact that KL is really a very viable place to have an office. So you may well see migration of some businesses out of Singapore into Malaysia. You won't see that. So they might have a little head office set up in Singapore, but the real guts of the business is going to be in KL, so we win. The other area that studies have shown where you've got to be very careful is the impact on those places along the route that are jockeying to have stations now. Because it doesn't always work the way you expect it's going to work. And to put it crudely, in some European cities they found that having a high-speed rail station has kind of sucked the life out of the city. You know, people would prefer to get on the train and go and work in, you know, wherever, Lyon or Toulouse or whatever. So that if, for example, you have Singapore connecting with Iskander, connecting with Malacca, say, and then KL, just as a hypothetical example, you might find Iskander turning into a bit of a dormitory for Singapore, which is, I don't think, the plan. So those dynamics have to be taken into account. But of course, improved communications always improve trade. Then working from home, I think, Yael, yes, I think as long as you have kids and nagging wives, most men will probably prefer to find an excuse to get out of the office, even if they go down to Starbucks to do their work. Yes, I think in the medium and long term, it's going to be a growing phenomenon that there will be less demand for office space. In fact, you can see it beginning to happen now because we're moving in some offices, some companies, to hot desking, where you don't actually have your own office, you don't even have your own cubicle anymore. You go into work and you find one that's available, and you sit there and plug in your own laptop. So obviously, it's a bit like operating a car park, isn't it? You know that there's going to be a certain level of vacancy every day with people not coming to work or taking their day off. So you can go from 100% to down to about 80%. And you know that statistically, everybody will still find an office. So yes, there will be some impact on that. Yeah.
I'm Gordon Seck here. Since you are specialized in commercial building, and I see there's a trend of China is buying Australia, UK, even LA and New York, a lot of high-end commercial building and hotel. What would you see China coming to Malaysia, especially in Malaysian government promoting world-class building, right? Like what's that? One BB and also the BBC. Bintang, all the world class. Mm-hmm. What would you see the Chinese coming over in Malaysia to extend to purchasing some of the commercial building?
Yeah, build them, I think, probably, and rather than just purchase them outright. Chinese remind me an awful lot of the Japanese 30 years ago, and they seem to be approaching the property development or the property industry through construction. And a lot of them are very construction minded. So that I've seen the portfolios of some of these very large Chinese companies, property companies. And it's absolutely staggering what they already own in terms of high-rise office buildings around the world, around the region and around the world. And in most cases, they haven't just bought them, they've built them and retained them for a long-term investment. So they've already been round, they've already scouted the market. It's, I think, absolutely inevitable that the amount of mainland Chinese ownership of Malaysian real estate will increase. And that will include a lot of the, that could well include prominent high-rise office buildings and retail, as well as just residential. Yeah, I think it's going to come.
Okay, thank you.
Bora for attending here. So my question is, we all know you are a professor in office sector. So as a real estate agent, if you don't mind, can you share with us whether if today I'm going to like not I, maybe some of the rest that you would love to market office sector.
Yes.
So what is the your opinion and what kind of specific criteria to become a successful real estate agent marketing office sector? I think I'm actually asking this on behalf of the floor. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I think what you're battling here is the kind of misconception that agents are mainly residential agents and don't know how to do office space. And actually, office agency is very simple. It's easy. You have to know your market. That's not difficult because the buildings are there, and you can easily get to know the landlords or the people in charge of leasing the space. I think for a start, if I were going to start in that way, I would set up my business so that the name of the business is associated with commercial space. In other words, don't call yourself sort of Star Homes or This Homes or That Homes, because then you're immediately putting yourself out of a race, aren't you? I mean, CBD, for example, is a great name because people can immediately identify it with commercial property. So find a name that conveys the right message. Learn the market very well, which is really not difficult, even though it's 100 million square feet or and growing. Familiarize yourself with all the usual legal requirements. So in other words, get to read office leases, find out how they work, not difficult at all. And then start probably in a small way and work your way up. It's a very good idea, if you're going to be serious about the business, to keep a diary so that you know when tenants go into a building, you'll know that they're on 3+3 or 3+3+3, so you can immediately, it's a bit like life insurance, if you like, you know when these tenancies are going to come up for renewal, and you should be there talking to these tenants now, about a year before expiry, asking them if they want to move. Of course, it goes without saying, you've got to invest a lot of personal energy and persistence, that's obvious. I think don't be put off by the big five, and they have their function, but increasingly there isn't a landlord in KL that won't accept the introduction of a tenant from any registered agent. You know, really, as I said earlier, real exclusive agencies are very, very unusual. So there's nothing to stop you go and knock on the door for the tenants, for the landlords. Finding the tenants, of course, is the challenging part. And I think in many cases, you really, there's no shortcut. Advertise, try and build up the business, deal with every inquiry very carefully, follow up. And in many cases, I mean, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, if you come across people who work in businesses in KL, just ask them, are you going to be looking for office space over the next year or so? You know, and it will build up and it will work. And we've seen two or three very, very successful agencies do just that. But as I said earlier, I'm surprised there just aren't more.